Hello, everyone. Let's see, do this twice. All right, let's bring the panel up. Come on, everybody. Let's see, there's somebody that we don't trust. There's somebody that we don't believe. There's somebody who doesn't tell the whole story. There's somebody who's just in it for the money. We've got journalists here. Katie, do you have the hand mic? Okay, so you've heard throughout today about the challenges that ethical journalists face in conducting the work that they care so deeply about. You've heard about the biases that we all bring to our understanding of the world or our desire to understand it. That can be depressing, or we can say it's quite a challenge. And that's why the last panel of the day is intended to have us focus on how to address the challenge. So what I'm going to do is...
Does this work over here? Yes. I want to leave being up here, and I want to join you, because we always believe that there's wisdom in the room as well as on the panel. So we'll start with the panel, but then we're going to talk to you as well. So let me tell you that on this panel, we have Don Garcia, who heads the Knight Fellowships at Stanford, who's really bringing together solutions in a new way. You have Marty Kaiser, a Pulitzer Prize-winning editor, who is now in newsrooms as a consultant helping effect change and also on the Democracy Fund as a fellow. You have Michelle Lee of the Washington Post, who is fact-checking her heart out on your behalf. And you have Stephen Ward, who is researching and writing about what he calls radical ethics. So I'm going to start, and I'm going to throw it first to Michelle, okay? Because Michelle, recently we were together in Washington, D.C. at a fact-checking summit. And Michelle was running a little conversation group about solutions as well. And one of the things that she talked about was the need to reach people where they are. Because I'm guessing that most of you who read Michelle's work with Glenn Kessler read it online or in print. But is that where the audience is always to be found? Where are you looking for them, Michelle?
Everywhere. So first of all, thanks for having me. For those of you unfamiliar with what we do, we're the Washington Post fact checker. I'm 50% of the staff. The other 50% is Glenn Kessler, who has anchored it since 2011. I joined in 2014. So we rate claims on a Pinocchio scale of 1 to 4, 4 being a total whopper and 1 being kind of like mostly true. So when I first joined Fact Checker, I realized that we already had a dedicated readership that reads us online and in print, but where is the audience that we're not reaching? How can I reach out to new people who may be interested but just don't know we're there or just haven't, you know, bought into what we do yet or just haven't seen the appeal? So I thought, you know, I should look at other social networks or social outreach methods that could appeal to other audiences. And I thought, you know, maybe I'll start experimenting. I started with Vine because I thought that was a social media tool that had a lot of potential, kind of went away, and then it was kind of making a renaissance back at the time. And I found the format way too restricting for what we do. There's a lot of nuance and details and a lot of complexities in a fact check that's really hard to distill into 6 seconds. I don't know what I was thinking. That didn't quite work. I knew that there was a really specific audience on Tumblr of young people who are actually interested in digging into things, who are curious about a lot of things, and who are interested in talking about it. But that didn't quite catch on either. Where I found success was on Snapchat, actually, because it provided a format where I could set up a quote and then give the fact check and then kind of go back and forth. And I could record myself, I could write about it via text, I could even use the emojis and later on a Bitmoji of myself. And it really appealed to a younger audience that just had not been reading fact checks on WashingtonPost.com. And I ended up interacting with a lot of them throughout the campaign, and it became the most engaged, the Snapchat that received the most engagement on the Washington Post Snapchat account for politics stories. We also have a newsletter that I started, and it's the fastest growing newsletter at Washington Post. And we find that people forward it to each other, and that's how a lot of readers sign up, and that just means that you're reaching them in their inboxes where they're not really expecting it. They got it forwarded from a friend who actually read it and thinks that you should read it too, and so it's spread by word. And now we're hiring a video editor to bring this to video too. So we're really trying to reach where people are. We have a large Facebook presence. We have a big Twitter presence too. And nowadays with President Trump tweeting a lot and us just being the two of us and not having the resource to write a full fact check about every single tweet, we started a new occasional series called What Trump Got Wrong on Twitter This Week. And that runs on Fridays, and it gives us a chance to do a roundup instead of devoting a full fact check to every single tweet. So we're trying to be as creative as possible, reach audiences where they are, and really grow.
So solution number one, be creative and reach people where they are. Don't expect them to come to you. We invited Dawn Garcia from the Knight Fellowships at Stanford so she could see what a really pretty campus looked like. And and Dawn has been with the Knight Fellowships as deputy director until last year when she got the big promotion. And the Knight Fellowships have changed over the years from a place in which journalists came to do a deep dive for a year into a subject that was important to them to now an entirely different focus. Dawn, you want to tell them why that's solution-oriented?
Sure, great. It is a beautiful campus, and I'm going to walk around after we're done, check the rest of it out. I'm the director of the John S. Knight Journalism Fellowships at Stanford. We, for 40 years, were a sabbatical focus model, and we switched because of all the transformation and disruption going on in journalism. So what we're doing is we're championing journalists who are going to be innovative and exploring the biggest challenges facing journalism, really tackling the big stuff. So we're committed to bringing in people who are going to be doers with a bias for action to explore solutions. So we're looking at seeding a lot of projects. Some of them really come to fruition in wonderful ways. A couple of things that I'll mention that are underway right now from some of our fellows. A colleague of there's the Hello Project, which is Yvonne Liao, who is working on something that two strangers sign up for a 20-minute video conversation that people have never met and realize how much they actually have in common. Kind of scary, but it works. Project Facet, which is Heather Bryant looking at ways for small newsrooms to collaborate. We believe collaboration is a really important piece of what we're going to be able to do if we're going to really help journalism in small places and big places. And the Trust Project, which is a way to explore how quality journalism can stand out in the chaos and really signal its trustworthiness. So those are some projects going underway. And one big new thing we're doing coming into the next year's class, we're picking the next class right now for next year, is to focus on five major themes that affects journalism, and to have people propose a question in one of those themes, calling it teams and themes, because again, I think collaboration is the way we're going to solve some big problems that we're facing. So we're looking at data journalism, we're looking at emerging technology, drones, video, VR, audience engagement and diversity, free speech and democracy, and news ecosystems and business models. And that last one, I would say, deserves a whole lot more conversation. We've innovated journalism a fair amount, but not the business model.
And one follow-up question to that. We find that on a campus the size of Stanford in the Silicon Valley, you've got tons of resources, but it took someone, meaning you, to find a way to get those organizations and resources to talk to each other and start working together much more closely. What have you done?
So there are actually, happily, a lot of people and organizations that care about journalism. I think we're seeing more of that now today than ever. At Stanford, on our campus, the Knight Fellowships, we're teaming up with like-minded folks on our campus that include the Brown Institute for Media Innovation, which is largely computer science students, the Stanford Journalism Lab, the Computational Journalism Lab, we're bringing in those students, the Stanford D School, the design school, which is not about designing drapes, it's about designing a human experience, the Graduate School of Business. So we're connecting all of these pieces to form a collaboration that's going to really help the fellows in our program and other people on campus get more traction on their projects and get more done.
So additional solutions you just heard, if you've got the deep pockets for something like a fellowship, revisit it to see whether or not it is really helping journalism as broadly as it can. And if you have the opportunity to draw other resources together, start talking to each other. So Stephen Wart, when I tweet, sometimes I'll put something out about journalism and I will get a response from someone who clearly has a political point of view and it tends to be conservative, and oftentimes they'll have a little flag as an emoji. They will call themselves a patriot. And it struck me when I do that journalists don't often call themselves patriots, but you have actually written and published quite recently that we need to embrace patriotism, but really have a clear definition of what it means. Stephen?
Oh, I argue that it's been the de facto master norm of journalism ethics, in the sense that it lies below the surface of most codes of ethics. You don't see the word in a lot of codes of ethics, but in fact, look at the history of war reporting and many other journalism through the centuries, what you will find is that when we are, our commitment to objectivity, our commitment to impartial news and independence gets really squeezed really hard when our country comes in competition with other countries, when it gets into a war with another country. And in many of those cases, it's a master norm in the sense patriotism will trump objectivity. We will not tell all the truth. I'm not disparaging all the great foreign reporters, of which I used to be, who have not done that. And what I'm saying is it is a emotion-laden, can-be-dangerous emotion if it is extreme, and it can cause journalists to act unethically, like not telling the whole truth or muting their criticisms of stuff like that. What I see now, if in terms of today, is a worrisome, narrow patriotism where, in fact, you can be called unpatriotic for writing things critical of the administration and some particular policies. And so patriotism can be an anti-democratic emotion and often has been in our history, including Canadian history. I'm a Canadian, okay? And in many ways, what I'm saying is that what we need to define more clearly, I'm not saying we don't have this concept, is a sense of moderate patriotism to democratic principles. And defining that, what that means in actual journalistic practice. So when the president says it is an act of patriotism to kill Obamacare, or you want to argue who the real enemies of the people are, who are the real unpatriotics in this country? I don't like that particular type of debate, but you would need a concept of patriotism that says the patriotism that fits journalists is criticism. Your job is to be critical. Spanish philosopher Jose Ortega y Gasset said, in a democracy, criticism is an act of patriotism. But there is in our society right now a lot of people who don't want to hear what they don't want to hear, and they're willing to label it as unpatriotic. So we have to fight back against that.
Okay, so patriot Marty Kaiser, you are now in journalism, in newsrooms, helping them transform and doing some of that work through the Democracy Fund. Where do you see hope?
I see hope in newsrooms realizing that they've got to change, that the financial forces are crushing them and making them having to rethink how they do things. I've done a bunch of work with the Boston Globe, and they've done some really impressive work thinking about where we're headed in the future and how are we going to grow. And it's not going to come through advertising, not they won't get some advertising, but really focusing on digital subscriptions. And other places have done this too, and saying, okay, then we're gonna pick out some topics and we're gonna really do them well. And we're gonna so well that people are gonna wanna pay for part of it. And then also it's realizing that part of that comes back that we talked about trust this morning. How do you build that trust? And one of the quickest ways, I think, is to realize, for reporters to realize that there are people out there who know a lot more about what's going on than they do. Just think of an instance, if you work at any company you work at and it gets written about, I will bet you that when you read it, and journalists, happens to them all the time, wait a minute, this person didn't understand this, they didn't get this right. So it's building the trust, focusing on things that matter to communities, and then trying to do them in such a way that doesn't come at it from such a political viewpoint. So if the issues are transportation, let's get transportation reporters that can talk to people about transportation, report about it, talk about what some of the solutions are. It could be healthcare, it could be all sorts of things, but pick some of those that you're really gonna do well and own them for your community, and that can transfer over even to smaller news organizations.
So we were talking at table six during the break. Can I put you on the spot? All right, stand up. And this is my signal to you that it's time for you now to start talking. So, Amelia, tell everybody the project that you're working on.
So I am studying politics and worldview in Waukesha County, Wisconsin. So if you're not familiar, it's one of the more conservative counties in the country and kind of was Charlie Sykes' base before. So,
And what are you learning and where is there hope?
So I think one of the things that is really important here is defending our ethics over other journalists, which can be hard, but I found that, you know, it's very us versus them right now. So if a journalist makes a mistake, it's like, well, we're journalists, so that's what happens. And in fact, I think that that kind of degrades the value of our ethics in other people's eyes, whether or not that's the intended effect. And so I've seen a lot of people saying, you know, there are no ethics. And I think instead it behooves us to say, no, someone crossed those ethics, and that doesn't mean that we don't have them. And another thing that's been really valuable is like looking in the mirror as a value for journalists. I think that's something that people see as part of being a journalist. You know, we are human. And so that constant humility to say, okay, I'm gonna check where my biases are. I wanna check, like, do I have issues when I talk to this group of people? What's keeping me from engaging and just observing? And so that goes a long way.
Engaging, Michelle, as some of these folks start getting their questions ready for everybody. How do you engage? Do you hear from your audiences? And what is your advice for engagement?
I do hear from audiences, people who are critical and people who are supportive. And I like to engage with my critics, and we encourage that between me and Glenn, both privately and publicly. You know, people will call me out on Twitter. If I responded to every troll, I would probably not have any other time in my day than doing that. So I try to pick where I can engage in a productive conversation. When readers email me who say, you know, I believe that you had a biased analysis based on these factors, and if they take the time to write me, then I will write them back and say, you know, thank you for your thoughts. I see what you're saying. However, this and this. And I find that those one-on-one interactions with readers really does build trust between me and them. Recently, we had a fact check of a gun control group, they advocate for more gun control, but it was, you know, whether silencers are, you know, they make guns actually really quiet, kind of like you see in the spy movies where it's like, pew, and you don't hear it. It's not like that, and we compare decibel levels, and that's just not the case, and we awarded it 3 Pinocchios. Somebody who read it emailed us and said, you idiots, you don't know anything about guns, blah, 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 blah. 10 minutes later, they emailed back and said, oh, I actually just read your fact check. And you did a really thorough job, and I just was not expecting the Washington Post to issue 3 Pinocchios to a claim that could make gun control advocates, you know, say that they were inaccurate about something. Now, if they were a regular reader of the fact checker, they would know that we've been really hard on both sides of the gun debate, both sides on abortion debate. Basically, any debate, we're really hard on you if you're not getting it right. But then you come across a reader who has this preconceived idea that, you know, we must be liberal. You're writing about Trump a lot. Of course you're a Trump hater. I recently got added onto a Twitter list of journalists who hate Trump, which is just not the case, but it's the preconception that people have of us. We fact-check people who are in the news, who are newsmakers, and right now a lot of newsmakers are Republicans. They're in control of the White House, they're in control of Congress, state governments, at so many of the levels. And we can't help that. What we try to do is to be fair to both sides and look for ways to fact check both sides as critically as possible. And when we find readers like that who are somehow pleasantly surprised, I think that we start engaging them and earning their trust, and that it builds our credibility.
Show me your hands if you have questions, anyone. I'm going to run to the front. All right. Please identify yourself.
Oh, my name is Meg Thino. And my question is for all of the journalists, I guess, in the room, on the future of photojournalism and the impact that it has on newspapers and communities. And now it's probably more likely called multimedia journalism. But many organizations are skimming the forces for that and translating it into wire services, freelance, not true freelancers, but reporters and everything. And some of the scale and quality of photojournalism can be hurt by that. And I want to know what people think about the future.
Who would like that?
I think some of what's being done, when you mentioned multimedia, is improving our journalism. It's the stories are much more understandable. It explains them better. We have to get out of this trap that everything is just words on paper, that there's lots of other ways to tell stories and to explain them so that people understand them. It has to be done well.
Are they trying to have photojournalists paid for the work they do is a challenge? I don't know if that's part of your question, but there's some people looking at how that might be improved, but that is one of the challenges facing photojournalism.
Don, you've gone to lengths, even among the fellows at Stanford, to have multimedia training for them as one of the options that they can take. In fact, some cases I think it was required, correct?
Yeah, so I would agree with Marty that there are so many ways to tell stories now. So podcasting, photojournalism, Snapchat. I mean, the options are many, and I think that one of the great things is for journalists to really have lots of tools to do their jobs well. So we have offered all kinds of training for fellows, and the fellows have trained each other. And I think that's one of the things that can really benefit. I'm sure people in this room have so many skills to train each other, and that's another way to go at it.
I think the question, part of your question is reducing the resources to do photojournalism and the number of people. I think the great side, and I agree with that, compared to when I was a working journalist, the ability to tell stories visually is unbelievable right now, and it's very exciting. I'd love to be a journalist, I think, a little bit younger, and try my hand at that. But I sense in your question a real question about money and resources and newsrooms and something. They just did a survey of Canadian journalists in Canada, and they asked them, what was the one thing that Canadian journalism needs? And the answer was, money. Money, yes, pay raise maybe, but money in the sense of resources to do great journalism. So I'm sensing, if that is what you're worried about, I share your concern.
But we also live in a time in which people sometimes don't believe something unless they have visual evidence of it. And sometimes even that evidence can be selectively put together. I think about the memification of news and also of hoaxes. Stephen, could you talk a little bit about how we can use all of the skills that we have, all the critical thinking skills that we have? When my emotions get revved up, because I get something in my Twitter feed or my Facebook feed that's a meme that says, Michelle Obama wants $160,000 pension for her mother because she babysat the kids at the White House, right? And it's all in one picture. It's all self-contained. I don't have to click. I can just get mad and share it, right? Michelle does a long form fact check on that, says it's absolutely not true, but in the meantime, that thing has been retweeted many times. How do we fight that?
That's what we were talking about this morning. It's a very difficult problem. I think you can, as people suggested this morning, that you just keep doing great journalism, you fight it with fact checking, you fight it as best you can. On an individual level, you do not allow yourself to overreact as a journalist if that's what you're thinking about. I do think, however, there is going to be a substantial amount of the public sphere full of this, no matter what we do. And it is broader and more deeper then fixing journalism, important though that be, it's a cultural problem that has to go back to not only media literacy, but cultural literacy and civic literacy back in our schools, where we relearn the basics of our Constitution, of our country, the importance of communicating respectfully but robustly with each other, and how to use media and the impact that publications like that have. That's one thing you can do, right? And it is not just the journalists need to do this, but everyone.
Michelle, you are a vice president of the Asian American Journalists Association. One of the real questions that a lot of the minority journalism organizations are asking is has fake news pushed the conversation about diversity off the radar, perhaps temporarily? But that's all the buzz. What did we talk about all day long today? How diverse are we in this room today, right? How does having a diverse staff connect to truth and trust?
That's a really good question. So at the Asian American Journalists Association, we're committed to increasing diversity in newsrooms and making sure that there's fair and accurate coverage of diverse communities in journalism. And we are very strongly dedicated to training journalists to become people who are aware of diversity issues. You don't have to be a minority journalist to be aware of minority issues. You just have to know that there are issues that require certain sensitivities and context when you cover them. For example, right now, through AAJA, I helped start the Muslim American Task Force, because Muslim America oftentimes gets covered as a reaction to the immigration order, or as a reaction to some type of a terrorist activity. That's not a fair and accurate coverage of Muslim America. So we're developing tools to help newsrooms to diversify their coverage about Muslim America, to make sure not every story has to be about hijabs. If you're writing about women who are of Muslim descent, or who are Muslims. And I do think that diversity, There's a certain level of, there's an attitude where, you look around your newsroom and you say, okay, there's an Asian there, there's a black person there, there's a Hispanic person there, good, we're set. That's just not it, Your newsroom can look very diverse, but if you're not supporting with your newsroom resources for your journalists to attend conventions by AAJA or the National Association of Black Journalists or Hispanic Journalists, if you're not supporting their growth within their community and making sure that they have the opportunity to speak up in the newsroom, it doesn't matter that you have people who just look different. And also, you don't have to necessarily look different to have a diverse background. You can be a white man and have a really interesting background of things that I had never experienced, that you might think I did just because I'm an Asian woman. It's just, it gets really siloed into a very basic understanding of diversity. And despite the continued efforts of our groups, there's just not enough diversity in newsrooms, especially in the high-ranking positions. I mean, how many Black, Hispanic, Asian news managers are there? How many news executives are there? How many Asians are in this room? How many Black people are in this room? Talking about this kind of stuff, listening to each other, and I think it needs to be always on our minds, as well as fake news and, this discussion, but it should not take a back seat.
I think journalists should be able to chew gum and walk at the same time.
So that's the short version of what
I
just
said. I really. So that means that, yes, fake news is a huge issue right now. Certainly the crisis in the financing of journalism is a huge issue, but diversity should be something that we could continue to work on, pursue, just as an integral part of what we do. I like to think of diversity as an accuracy issue, and that if we are not diverse in our staffing, in our coverage, in our mindset, we're not accurate, because we're not telling all the stories. So that's another way to frame it. And I'd like to say that I think Michelle's got, her group's got some great ideas, but really, it's all of us who should be thinking this way. And I think that some of the things going forward on how people talk to each other and have conversations going forward is gonna really rely on diverse newsrooms and mindsets.
I think one of the other issues, too, is the importance of the culture in a newsroom. The thing that makes the best journalists are people with curiosity, mm-hmm. and you want to surround yourself with people that have different backgrounds, are interesting, that will add to that, and make sure that you're listening to them as you're doing stories. And there's always someone who knows more that you can learn from. You mentioned fake news this morning and the whole discussion of the day. I want to go back again because that phrase, I just think that the more that we allow that to be used, it sort of delegitimizes almost everything that what we're trying to do. And that also the trying to sort of put labels on the Washington Post or the New York Times, or this is a liberal one, or this is somebody else. The real purpose of, I think, a major purpose of journalism has not changed. And holding the powerful accountable, whether they're politicians, powerful people, whether they're institutions, shouldn't change. And so we break into these labels, we have problems. And one other point, and it goes to something that Michelle was touching on, and I ran into as 18 years as an editor, I would hear from people on both sides of the issues. I wish at times I could make the two listen to each other. In fact, one week I did a column where I took the phone calls from both sides. I took their names off them, but basically they're the basic phone calls, and they were attacking each other. You're too liberal. You're too conservative. You don't know what you're about. And lastly, we did a study about 15 years ago. And one of the more interesting things was, and it goes to a point that was made here this morning about people want to be in their tribes and be heard to be alike. And the people who read us the most were the most devoted readers and the highest penetration newspaper in the country. We're the most critical of what the Journal Sentinel did. People who were sort of average readers gave us high marks. They liked the brand. They think they think it's nice. But if you really read us regularly, you were tougher on us. And I can't think of another product that's sort of like us. The less you like us, the more you read us. But what's going on there is people, I believe, were reading us so heavily that they couldn't find everything that they agree with. I loved, there was like 20 or 30% that wanted to read differing opinions every day. Boy, I love those people. But the other ones, they'd see the stuff they liked, but they couldn't understand why that other stuff was there. And that's what scares me going forward. I think that was acerbated by cable news and talk radio, picking off a place where you could hear everybody who's like you.
Marty, picking up on that point of labeling a newspaper, the Post, is the solution that news organizations, don't editorialize?
I think opinion journalism has a place for it. I think we have slipped away, and it's tougher on your phones and on the web to label it. I think it needs to be clearly labeled. If it's a news analysis, if it's an opinion piece, there's too much stuff out there that doesn't have an opinion label on it.
I'm talking about editorial.
I wouldn't. Yeah, and I think that's a real tough one, because I could have written a column every day in the paper explaining that the editorials were different from the news part of the paper, and I'm not sure people still would have got it. But I'm not sure that I would throw editorials out. I do sometimes kind of cringe that I know exactly what certain publications are going to say.
But don't editorials help define the image of the paper?
I think it does help define it, but I'm not too sure that that's going to remove the issue. Do you think that the news reporting I always thought the news reporting historically, I'll pick on Rupert Murdoch, but until Rupert Murdoch owned the Wall Street Journal, I didn't think that there was any mix there. They had a tough right-wing editorial page, and they did some of the greatest reporting in the country. They still do some outstanding reporting, don't get me wrong. But I don't think them getting rid of their editorial page, I don't know whether it would change people's view.
Well, let me shift over to Stephen for a moment, because I keep thinking about Amelia visiting Waukesha County and talking to people who have strong conservative beliefs, who listen to Charlie Sykes driving into work in the morning, and all agreed with him that the mainstream, what he called mainstream media, had collective liberal viewpoints and were so blind to their own biases that they were not really fully reporting the news, or they were keeping news from people. Now, you take the position that, in fact, journalists should support a liberal democracy, I believe is the term you use. Tell us what you mean by that.
Well, I think that, in fact, journalists are engaged and have goals, and we should be quite explicit about that. There isn't a journalism ethics that I'm aware of in any culture that does not have a political social view behind it. In this country, in Canada and other Western countries, it tends to be liberal democracy. But of what kind? What I'm worried about in the current situation is that the word democracy is a pretty flabby word. It can mean very, very different kinds. It can mean a populist democracy centered around a strong man. Or it can mean an egalitarian, plural, respectful to minorities democracy, searching for equality, and so on and so forth. What I think right now is that that latter form of liberal democracy is up for grabs. And that part of our job as journalists is to make sure that this constitutional egalitarian, this ideal that we have of democracy is not lost. So that means, in many ways, that in fact, our goals as journalists, we do have goals. We are engaged in that sense. But they're large, very large goals. They're not narrow partisan goals. And the methods we use to report on that democracy and to support those values should be as impartial and as informed and rational and fact-based as any. The other thing that I might say that is that what I heard this morning is that although fact checking and fake news and all that is centered around the word fact, I'm actually worried about issues that go beyond the simple statement or misstatement of a fact, which I'm not sure, I'm not blaming that, attributing that to people who are here this morning. I'm really worried about other things like attitudes, intolerances, social prejudices, the sort of policies that the administration in the White House will try to bring down, and what are we going to report on that, and how are we going to respond to it? That goes a little bit more. Of course, that issues comes, it could generally be come under fact in the sense that some of these policies are not based on fact. But I'm more concerned that, in fact, as journalists, we're going to keep our eyes on defending the sort of free liberal democracy that we have. I know that makes me very unpopular among certain traditional journalists because we're supposedly neutral, but I don't believe in neutrality. I don't think journalists should try to be neutral in that very restrictive sense.
I'm Robert Chappell with Madison 365. We're a nonprofit news outlet here in Madison, primarily focused on communities of color. There was a mention of business model in the intro. I think, Dawn, you've been doing some work on that. And I wonder, what is the business model going forward? What in the post-truth era, is it all going to be nonprofit?
Yes? I've got the answer.
All right, good.
First of all, one of the things that I don't think there is the business model. So I think for journalism, for some time, there has been a general business model, certainly for newspapers. But I think we're really going to need to look for many different ways to build revenue to pay for the journalism we need. So there's a lot of things, a lot of experiments out there. Some of them are working. Certainly, the Washington Post is trying a variety of things, the New York Times, but some smaller organizations, from subscription models to membership models to, yes, you know, advertorials, the old advertorial coming back as sponsored content, finding ways to repackage the great journalism that is created and then used once. Are there ways to reuse and repackage and repurpose? There's the Texas Tribune, which many of you know probably does a great job with events. So there's a lot of things that are being tried. I don't think there's going to be one thing that will, well, maybe there will be one thing that will surface, but I don't think there will just be one.
Dawn, as a follow-up to that, there's been some conversation about what, if anything, does Google, Facebook, the ode to democracy, essentially, because of what those organizations have done to the business model, including fairly recent writing by Emily Bell at the Tau Center saying, you know what, you've got a bigger role to play. Why don't you underwrite journalism? So you're out there working with them. What's your perception of, Has there been any change in the perception on those industries, those digital industries, on those platforms, that they owe anything to journalism?
I think there's been an evolution. It's been slow, but it's happening for the platforms that are, which the Tau Center report, which just came out a couple of days ago, talked about this, which are really now becoming news organizations, even if they don't want to call themselves that. I think it's being handled very differently from Google and to Facebook, especially those two, the biggies. Google has been putting a lot of effort into this, into thinking, in some ways, it's maybe a little self-serving, which is, let's not have what happened in Europe happen elsewhere. we don't want to have a lot of laws that are going to restrict what we do, so they are helping. But there is, I think, a genuine interest in the people that I know at Google to try to help newsrooms to figure out things like AMP. How many of you know the Accelerated Mobile Pages project to help newsrooms have their pages load more quickly on mobile so that people will not click off and go somewhere else? I think Facebook's a different animal, and those of you who follow this have watched the comments from, say, Zuckerberg saying, didn't have anything to do with what happened in the election, to now having a journalism project where they're working with newsrooms. They both, though, have different business models. So Google is trying to make all the information available to the world, and Facebook would like you to like everything and share and create networks, and they don't want to step in as an editorial arbiter of truth or trust in that kind of a way. So I think you're seeing two very different reactions from those organizations. I think it really is incumbent on the public and journalism to continue to ask questions and to push them to be part of this conversation, because they have taken a very big role, even if they don't want to acknowledge it.
Yeah, I'd like to also jump in there and make a plug for the International Fact-Checking Network, which is run at Poynter by Alexio Spenzarlis, who started Pagella Politica in Italy. So political fact-checking began in the US with factcheck.org, PolitiFact, and the Washington Post fact-checker. And since then, it's grown all over the world, even before this recent election. And now it's in, I believe, 60-some countries. And there are new fact-checking organizations coming up in different countries all the time. And so the International Fact-Checking Network has been working with Google and Facebook to try to work on those initiatives that they're starting to highlight fact-checks and to stamp out, get rid of some of these like viral fake news stories that are circulating on Facebook. And the International Fact-Checking Network has come up with a code of principles, such as you have to be a nonpartisan organization, you have to be transparent about your funding, you have to be transparent about your methods. You have to have a similar method that fact-checkers take on, which is that you engage with the speaker and you say, what is your source, and you give them a chance to respond, and you do your independent fact-checking. And you have to adopt and agree to all of those codes of principles in order to participate in the International Fact-Checking Network. And I think that the work of IFCN is really even raising the basic level of journalistic standards all over the world, and it's great to see that.
Sharon Dunwoody here in Madison. I wanted to ask the panel about the role of analysis in a robust journalistic future. I'm a dedicated newspaper reader, still have hard copies delivered at the bottom of my driveway every morning, and I've been impressed over the years now with the incredible amount of analytical text I have access to in these outlets. Some of it's data journalism, but a lot of it is deeply reported, thoughtfully written. And for those of you old-fashioned hard copy people, I can sit in the morning now with my New York Times, and at the top of a page is a news story, the bottom is an analysis of the issue. And they even modify the way they lay these out so you can identify them easily. And that increase in analysis has begun to strike me as an incredibly valuable part of the journalism that I see today. Is it valuable to anybody else?
I think it's tremendously valuable. I often wondered, that for the people who are using their handheld devices, and I'm not sure this is going to happen, by the morning you know all the news. You know what's happened. And to have a well-written, thoughtful analysis is tremendously important. One of the recommendations that came out of Jay Rosen and New York and where we're going in the future and money for a website is that you don't publish every minute, that you think about and get it right, that you or provide the analysis. I don't mean necessarily get it right, but do an analysis. Give me something deeper. Tell me something more.
I think it's incredibly important and has repercussions for journalism ethics and for teaching of journalism. I really think that more and more journalism is interpretive, analytical. Some of it's good or bad, and we need to teach, come up with norms that of evaluation. What do we mean by a really good interpretive or analytical piece? But I think we need to teach more and more students to have the knowledge, the cognitive skills, the background, the ability to write in this analytical mode and without the sort of partisanship that infests so much commentary. The existence of this analytical, descriptive, interpretive part of journalism is really almost a godsend, if I can use that phrase, for me. And I guess with I share her love of it all.
One more quick point. The research we did on the interest in that kind of reporting, the number one thing that men were interested in this state was not investigative reporting. It was number two. For women, it was number one. Of course, number one for men was the Packers.
Go ahead.
So when I get up in the morning, I can read the Wall Street Journal, I can read the Wisconsin State Journal, or about 3,000 other things in many different mediums. What role does the destruction of mass audience as our baseline play in the issues and the challenges we've been talking about, from business model to ethical issues and value-based? Smaller and smaller groups are being targeted around causes, values, religions, demographics, interests, you name it, just to survive and get their little niche audience. So what role does the loss of the mass audience play?
I mean, I think it becomes, there's a phrase called distributive information systems now. What it means is that people obviously get their information from so many different places. I think there is a real question whether this is beneficial in the long run or not. For democracy, I think the first effect that I can think of is that it just increases the silo nature of our information getting, and decreases the amount of sharing of views across platforms, and running into something by serendipity that in fact you didn't know existed, or even a point of view you disagree with. So it increases that. It might, though, on the other side. I mean, I'm trying to think of the positive effects, is it allows people to actually write more deeply about very specific topics from specific perspectives. What we have seen is that the notion that we had of democracy is based on an informed public, singular, not plural, singular public, that had common topics, viewed common media, and came to some reasonable judgment on that. It's absolutely, does anyone really believe in that? And I think if not, then we're all fooling ourselves here today. I think to a certain extent, everything we say here runs up against what Charles was saying earlier today, is that we want to produce all this great journalism. And look, I love all of this, and I love it a lot. But is it going to penetrate? Is it going to get through when you're distributed in such a manner? So that's my concern, Herman.
One of the issues that was brought up earlier is journalists kind of looking in the mirror. How can reporters kind of do that, to sort of step outside of themselves, consider their own biases, consider the ways or the things that are shaping their perspectives, and how can we sort of do that to improve coverage and ultimately do a better job and build more trust?
I think one of the things... I was with Andy Hall's group, Wisconsin Center for Investigative Journalism, yesterday. And one of the things we talked about, the steps going through investigative reporting. And one of the things that I think that reporters at times forget to do is drill in not just on the facts of their stories, but what are their own biases? What did they bring to it? and this sort of whole checklist of what you're what you're going after. Yeah. And as I think there's more discussion than I've ever seen about this, and it used to be, well, I'm just going for the truth, and start asking questions of editors, other reporters as you go through your reporting. It's not easy.
I just got to jump in because I couldn't agree more with that. Is that everyone thinks objectivity is an external fact to you, or impartiality is that way? No, it begins with internal passion, a passion to get the truth of this story, this matter, so badly that you're willing to go through the mental discipline of being fair, of being accurate, of standing back from your beliefs and being critical. And if you think that's easy, you're fooling yourself. And you have to have that, not only the passion to get the story, but the passion to get it right. It's an objectivity is infused with passion, it's infused with value, and it is not this dry, cold, heartless thing, which I've tried to tell everybody about, and they don't always believe me. But it's because I think you have to see it as a psychological stance and that you bring to your journalism. It's not some sort of rule that's up there that you coldly follow.
To just jump on what Stephen said, I think it starts at the beginning. When you start talking about some story that you're going to go after, if you're starting with curiosity and how do I find out about it, and to me there's a difference when people would bring stories and they bring an opinion, or they would bring, I don't know about this. I've heard about this. I found this information out. And that's my criticism, which you heard me talk earlier about cable news, where people spout off that haven't done one bit of reporting. Let me go for a second.
Spend
millions of dollars to have some host of some morning show when they're citing other people's news. Take those $5 million you're paying the host, hire some reporters, and do some news yourself.
All right. Go for it.
Yeah. Also, and I think that's a great comment, and I think really deploying the resources, PBS, I'm sorry, runs BBC News. That's not really, they pay a lot of money for it, too. A few less game shows, more actually pursuing news.
Little signs wonderful. Over the head, I've never done any reporting on the topic, but I'm going to comment on it.
Exactly.
I did 10 years ago.
Exactly. And also introspecting on our own profession and our love of long-form journalism. Where does that come from? Not the reader, I don't think. I mean, I've noticed the Times has gone away from it.
From long-form journalism?
They're not doing nearly as much as they did.
Boy, they've done some remarkable things in the last year. Hopefully what they're doing, I will argue that, agree with
well,
you.
Well, you're arguing, are you wrong?
Okay. Hopefully what they're doing is they're not just letting stories kind of go on forever that don't tell you something. When they do it really well. The magazine, it was all devoted to the refugees.
I'm not talking about the magazine. I'm talking about the daily newspaper that everybody reads. And they've gone much shorter. A lot of papers have. And the good news is people are backing off from awards-based journalism and learning to write shorter and covering everything and not thinking that we're going to spring another Watergate because there's a million Watergates right now. All you got to do is connect the dots every day. The access that journalists have now to documents and to people around the world to report things, that used to pass as investigative journalism. You know, those took months.
We spent a lot of time talking about Washington, New York. How about some of the small towns where no one's watching the school board? No one's watching the
Agreed.
City council.
This is my biggest concern.
Agreed.
Scares me. Or maybe I should be a city councilman in one of those places.
Well, right. I mean, speaking of the importance of having investigative work in local markets, just speaking from a fact-checking perspective, PolitiFact does a really good job working with local news stations to bring fact-checking to local markets. And that's a great example of reaching audiences where they are and reaching them through outlets that they trust. You know, news viewers really trust their local networks because they watch it all the time. And if you bring fact-checking to there, it's not Washington speaking down on you. It's your new local news network speaking with you to explore the facts about your local politics with you. And so I think when you talk about what opportunities there are, especially in fact-checking, I think there's a lot of opportunity in local markets.
I think there's some efforts going on to piggyback on Michelle's really good comment about having citizens and journalists looking together at, or both of them having access to, documents, to important information. There's a couple of projects going on, the FOIA machine, which has been a way, makes it easier for you to, anyone, to put in a Freedom of Information Act request, which is always kind of daunting, and many journalists have never even done one. And so the idea of really, you know, holding the powerful accountable and checking on what's going on, and that being done by citizens as well as journalists.
Dave Gordon from the International Society of Weekly Newspaper Editors. Marty, you almost got down to that level a moment ago when you were talking about covering local school boards, but I think 99% of the conversation this morning has been about the metropolitan dailies of various sizes. I'd like to point out a couple of things. One is that the weeklies are probably the healthy part of the newspaper industry these days, by and large. They're also the part of the industry that I think has a fairly loyal and engaged and credible relationship with its readers. What we're wrestling with at this point is trying to figure out a way that the weeklies will be able to do more analysis than they can with 2-3-4-person shops of the impact on the local communities of the policy changes that are coming out of Washington. We haven't solved that one yet, but at least we're beginning to try to come to grips with the fact that it is a lack, but that the credibility base does exist there.
I just spent a few days at the Wisconsin Newspaper Association, came away incredibly impressed, as I always do, the battle that weekly newspapers, smaller newspapers are doing. And a lot of the discussion of the fear that are we getting was the attack on the New York Times or attacked by Trump, is it going to affect us and going to affect the coverage we do? And I get, as I heard earlier this morning, I get a little bothered by when somebody says sort of the liberal media and then seems to paint newspapers, news organizations, I'd like to say now, across the country, that this is what it is. And that's just not the case. The good news is Pew, I believe it's Pew or May, I think it's American Press Institute, is about to do the kind of research that we hopefully, they do the research and that it gets published. And I think it will show, like someone mentioned this morning, that you may be frustrated with the media, because I don't know what that means. I probably say I would be if I lump it all together. But if you start asking me about, and I live in a town around the United States, I bet I give a lot higher marks, and it will be interesting to see how that survey comes out.
Let me just add that there was a piece in Columbia Journalism Review just recently by Trudy Lieberman that talked about the opposition to the proposed Health Care Act was largely driven by local reporting that talked about the impact at local levels. And so right now, even if you have three people in your newsroom, if you can devote one of them to Medicaid, if you can devote one of them, and you're going to run wire copy perhaps instead, but you're going to find whatever it is that affects your community. There's a television station in Indianapolis that has one reporter that is a carrier expert. So when the newly elected president went to Indianapolis, made the announcement about the supposed many jobs that were being saved at Carrier, the young man who had been on that beat did an analytical report that night that fact-checked it and said those numbers are not accurate and reported on the people who were still about to lose their jobs. Margaret?
So this is for Michelle, but obviously for anyone else too. What do you think, you know, since we were talking about diversity, what do you think about the idea of hiring or considering ideological diversity in the newsroom? You know, diversity is easy to see if it has to do with race or gender, but, you know, what about the kind of diversity that, you know, has to do with background or worldview, or even, dare we say, you know, where you're coming from politically?
Right. I think diversity is not just how you look. It's everything about your background. How many people in your newsroom has shot a gun? Ask your newsroom that. It might be a lot, it might be very few, and that could tell you something about your newsroom. How many people in your newsroom has served in the military? You don't know just by looking at them most of the time. Mm-hmm. And these experiences are what make our newsrooms richer and what make our coverage more fair, more accurate, and more reflective of what's actually going on in the world, and not just through our lens of what we think is happening, but just based on our own experiences that bring that unique perspective to our reporting. So I am a huge champion of diversity of all aspects, not just the people who look a certain way, but who have a rich and interesting and unique background who can really add perspective to coverage. If you just have one set of ideals in one newsroom, what are you accomplishing there? You're not challenging other people's thinking, you're just kind of speaking in your own bubble. And I am a complete champion of diversity of everything.
Let me go back to what I started with, which is that we believe that there's a significant amount of wisdom already in the room, and truly put you all to work. What I'm going to ask you to do, because we still have a little time left, is to take 5 minutes, and I'd like you to turn to the person next to you and talk about what solution, if there was one solution that you would like to bring forward toward increasing trust in journalism in these days, what would it be? And I'd like you to talk to your partner, and if your partner thinks you've got a really good idea, then I want that person to rat you out. All right? So go ahead, you've got 5 minutes.
There's no one solution, I guess. And none of them are absolutely going to work, right? There's so many forces against.
We just sent each other a classic jail. We've got another jail.
Obviously.
Oh my God, now I got to talk to Dawn. Oh, Jesus.
But how you do that, right?
This is really great to meet you. I heard so much about you, and just as always,
my mind is
blank. I was looking forward to writing.
Two more minutes.
do you have them?
You are a minor.
That's all. And you'll probably get into those communities being talked to.
I'm so struggling. We're about to move to the East Coast, and I need to break the pattern. So it's kind of when I'm not busy, I spend too much time. I hear from a lot of. So I'm overprepared for something. And I do like the part I've got. So different than work. You just email your friends and say, help you get this job, and you can do this. And wait, you can call me later and talk to me for an hour. So anyway, we're going
to make some things on the East Coast.
We sold our house much faster than I thought. We're going to move out to Annapolis, which is sort of, maybe I'll get a hobby to control in life. But also the work, the people I've done, the proposals I make, when you make them commercial, it would literally be like, send an email. And it was like, no,
there's not much we can, I mean,
so I'm really happy with you. I mean,
No, there's so much interest right now amongst students. Yeah. Teach them about this. When I go to talk to students, I always say, diversify your course that way.
1 minute. 1 minute, everybody.
My favorite thing would be to actually go for media literacy, but also cultural literacy among students.
So in my positive model, I sometimes say, Now it's like,
how about, you know, just saying, let's have the resources in mind.
Right, that's right. And so then.
I mean, you can.
Someone please just pay for everything.
Yes, please.
I would have done more if we had the free. It's an experiment. The last few months I was here, actually, Tom Rosenstein and I came up with this thing that we did at our place.
Anyway, okay, everybody, can I get you back?
The thought was,
could I get you to come back?
How do we sort of
hello? Yo! Okay. Here's what I've discovered. Journalists talk with their hands. I have seen, you looked amazing. I saw, we got to stop doing this, and no, this is the point, and maybe, right? But now I want to hear what you had to say. Okay? If you heard, I saw that. Yes, bring it forward. So, what did you hear from your partner? Give me some exercise. What did you hear? I saw a hand somewhere. Who did it? Oh, come on. Okay. Right.
I learned how to use my iPhone to tape things because I have trouble with accuracy.
Okay, so we've got to make certain that we redouble our efforts to document, huh?
Yeah. Right?
What else? What else did you hear? Yeah.
Stand up if you're ready, okay? You got something to stand up.
So like this?
Yeah.
We discussed, in particular for newspaper journalists, being letting people see you more as a person. I think a lot of newspaper journalists don't like, they like to be at an arm's length. And having credibility means also letting people know who you are and that you come from the same place and that you're on their side. Not necessarily against them, but on their side.
Yep. Many years ago, when I was a reporter, I adopted a dog that was feral. She'd lived in a park. Marty's paper did a story about it, because it was kind of an unusual human interest story. I can't tell you how many sources I developed from adopting a dog, because anybody who liked dogs suddenly developed trust in me. And the joke was, my boss said, you know, we ought to be paying a PR firm to get dogs for all of our staff. But as a colleague of mine for the many years I was at the Poynter Institute said, the more personal we are, the more universal we become. And he said it in writing, right? That's what draws people to good writing. So yes, we've always said, I'm not the story, the story's the story, right? But maybe you are the story in ways that still can help people connect with you and build trust and still do it journalistically. Who else? Come on. You weren't just sharing recipes, I know. All right, can you shout? Got a big voice? Relevance. Okay. Look for stories that relate to people's lives. What else? Okay.
And then I want a girl to ask.
I'll stop on my way to you.
Right here. Education, starting in primary and secondary schools, so that you teach kids to trustworthy things.
And I think what you're saying is really important because, you know, we've more recently started talking about news literacy, but there has been a media literacy movement that's gone on for some time that has been somewhat offended by the fact that the journalists folks, you know, came in and started saying, well, just talk about news. It isn't PR for journalists. It is about media literacy in general, whether it's movies or ads or journalism. Over here.
One of the things, I'm not a journalist, so this is a layperson speaking, but my feeling is that perhaps for the people in local communities, small towns that don't have enough staff, I'll take an example from my background, which is banking. We had correspondent banks. Why can't there be an arrangement with some of the big papers, Washington Post, New York Times, the AP, where they have feeds into the small towns, into the newspapers. And if there's a way to compensate, because they're getting a bigger audience and a bigger voice in this, the outlying communities, perhaps it would be a nice way to get news in a variety of ways to a bigger audience, and an audience that may be more one, as you should say, or one.
There is a little bit of that with the Washington Post has arrangements. So if you're I think it's still in effect, you're a digital subscriber or a print subscriber to the Washington, to the Milwaukee Journal Sentinel, you also get the Washington Post. So some of that is taking place. The Post has been tremendous on that because they're really trying to build their audience.
And we also give subscriptions for people who have .gov and .edu email addresses and .mil. Right.
Yeah, and the same thing. It comes with your subscription to the Journal Sentinel.
This plays right off of that. We were comparing and contrasting small town weekly papers or local news organizations where you're in the community, you're reporting on the community, you damn well better get it right because these are your neighbors, versus national organizations where the decisions tend to be made in very, you know, little conference rooms on the East Coast. And the thinking being that maybe the editors on the I-95 corridor need to listen to their troops in the field and not push back so much, not be so preconceived with what they do and realize they too have to get it right.
Way over here.
You know they're not going to be your friends even when you get it right sometimes.
I guess as discussed before, diversity in all on all aspects is very like extremely important for the future of the news. I think it will give like a more variety of stories. It will, from what I've heard, like a lot of people comment on like they read a news story and they say, oh, this person who's reporting about it clearly hasn't had any experience in what or like encountered the actual events that they may be reporting about, and the diversity in all aspects and background, ethnicity, maybe like the just location where the person is from will give much more trustworthiness to the news.
Well, I want to jump in on that because I didn't mention this earlier when Margaret asked, but I think hiring managers really need to keep that in mind. And whatever hiring managers can do to help other editors spot these sort of differences in experiences between their job candidates would be very helpful, whether it's through training, again, sending them to conventions where, you know, we talk about issues of diversity, or just being really cognizant of it.
Just, I love the sense of place that you raised, because having a sense of place about where you live. I grew up in San Jose, California, and I later became city editor of my hometown paper. And being able to know and encourage other people to write and report in areas that they know, I think is really important.
Yeah, we talked about the really having a finger on the pulse of the health of your own newsroom. Our journalists, we had a photojournalist who was shot in the back by a pellet gun just a few weeks ago by someone who felt they wanted to scare a journalist. You know, our journalists are yelled at rallies, at political rallies. They're seen as the enemy at gatherings at the state capitol. Some of them are ready to raise their hand, throw their hands up, and give up. Not that because they're bad journalists, is, you know, a human can only put up with so much. So I think as far as the future of journalism, I'm a manager, have to make sure that we are super supportive of, so that they get the feeling of power when they go out every day to feel, I can endure this one more day to find the truth. And you said objectivity is infused with passion. If they don't have that passion, or if they lose that passion, how can we expect them to be objective? So it's very important to manage the health of your own newsroom.
Okay, and can I ask you, how do you support someone? Any specific other? You talk to the reporter. You tell them you support them. I mean, beyond that, is there other specific things that you can do? It's very similar to the case of trauma, that if you've been a foreign reporter or even a local reporter and you've been exposed to very traumatic events, for a long time in journalism, we didn't even recognize it as a problem. And a lot of it has to do now with the sort of support, listening, confidential services, and counseling services, but actually being aware that you need to be there for those people. It's a big deal, so I agree with you.
I second all of that. Also, we were talking about sort of local journalism and ways to engage readers in helping develop and track stories. So I thought what Rainey was talking about was Frontline this morning, where they're annotating the scripts so people can follow where things come from. But there's also reporters who are sort of annotating their work online as they're working on the story, so that people might have suggestions. So you're not going to do this if I'm going to try and establish that Mark is a crook. I'm probably not going to annotate that as I'm doing the story. But for a lot of stories, we can do that. We can say, here's what I've got so far. What can you tell me? And in some senses, do open sourcing on your stories.
Yep. We could really do a lot more on that. We did a story years ago where it started as a blog. Here's the story that we're going to be doing. Here's some parts of it. And it got sort of a following, got some feedback, had some people doing some responding internationally. And I'm kind of disappointed we didn't do it more often, because I made a great, long, well-done, long-form feature.
It also goes back to the I'm not the story frame that we have, and many times writing about how we did the story or the ethical challenges that we faced doing this story can give people a real window.
Ms. Duncan, to my right, is doing some research on a very similar thing, suggests online having sort of an explainer with every story. I'll let her explain a little more.
I just think that being very explicit with the reader and using design elements to tell them what the story has gone through and what heuristic cues to look for on news stories that make it simple and easy for them to distinguish credible stories from hoax stories can go a long way.
And improve the experience of reading the story. I mean, it's huge.
Most recently, probably within the last 2 weeks, the American Press Institute released a study that said their research found that people are more, they find the person who shares the story more credible than the actual source of the story. And when I read that, I thought, that's an immensely hopeful thought, because we as journalists work really hard to read things that are well-sourced. We're really careful. I think we are. So I ask you, what do you share? You have the power, because of your own personal credibility, to be sharing the best possible information. So if you are more credible than Michelle, she's the Washington Post. But when she does that work, as rigorous as you know it to be, turns out your friends like you more, right? Think of the power of that. You trust her, they trust you. And I don't think that we can talk about that enough. I recently talked to a group of journalists at Washington and Lee University and said, do you check the links of the things you share? Or do you just automatically share them? And if we all commit to making certain we never share a thing we haven't looked at, even if the headline looks luscious, or even if it makes you angry, and you think, damn, that's got to be good, and even if it says it was done by the Washington Post, if you know that you never share something that you haven't fully looked at, I shouldn't say fully looked at least know that it's legit, then you're not using your power to its fullest. So let's use that power. And let's thank our panelists who come today to give you solutions. And thank you. So now, Katie has to hustle on up here and give you her blessings. And we can release the panel. It's okay. You're allowed to go. You're so polite. This is the most obedient journalist I've ever seen.
Thank you, Jill. I think I'll just do this.
We're just shaking hands here.
Okay, I can't see that. All right, well, thank you so much, Jill, and the rest of that panel. What a great, hopeful way to end the day and take us all forward. I am going to give you a little bit of homework, because I like to teach people things. So again, I would like to thank all of our sponsors for their really generous support to bring us all together today. This would all be impossible without them. And thanks as well to our advisory board members who make connections with all of these sponsors. Again, those linkages are absolutely vital to the center's work. Thank you so much to our moderators, our speakers, our table discussion leaders. Thank you to everyone affiliated with the center, most especially Lindsay and our student fellows, and Mallory Perriman, the just unbelievably talented project assistant for the center. So I'm going to close with a little story before I give you some homework. A few years ago, I was interviewing a cardiothoracic surgeon for some work that I was doing, and he asked what my research agenda was. I said, what is it that I study? And I said, I study journalism ethics. And he smiled and said, is that a thing? He's a funny guy. I wish I could say that that was an isolated incident, but it's not. And I think you all know that. When I go out and I do a lot of talking about journalism and ethics, I do a lot of critiquing, I do a lot of supporting. I, you know, talk about it at cocktail parties, and I go out to community groups. I was just after the election, when President Trump was elected, I was in front of a group of very feisty liberals at the Madison Senior Center, and boy, did they want to talk about journalism ethics. Tell me all the things that we did wrong. My experience with most people is that they largely value journalism. They see its role in a democracy, but they're also very critical. They think journalists have ethics problems. On the flip side of that coin, I spend a lot of time with journalists, and I just don't think that these are people motivated in the main by profit and trying to get ratings. They're not all about their ego. Yes, there are bad actors, and yes, we make mistakes, but largely the people that I encounter doing this work are really trying to do it with integrity, with courage, in the public's interest. I love to tell the story of journalism. I'm truthful about the story of journalism, but I love to tell it. I think it is a great story. But then we see something like a person manufacturing t-shirts that say rope, tree, journalist. And I couldn't agree more with one of our later commentators there about how hard that is. How hard it is to take care of yourself doing this work when you feel that people don't trust you, and when you hear terms like post-truth era. I have trouble even saying it. It makes me shudder. So what to do about this disconnection between people who value journalism but think it's flawed, and people who are trying to do journalism and do it right? How do we get past that? I spend a lot of time listening to and reading an author and advocate named Brian Stevenson. If you haven't read his book, Just Mercy, you are missing out. Go order on Amazon, read it. He's not writing about journalism. He's writing about race and social division. But one of the things that he focuses on really applies to journalism in my mind. He talks about proximity. And his main argument is that when we allow ourselves to separate from each other, or when we do it purposefully, we lose our sense of each other as people. We lose trust. We lose empathy. And I think that that matters in journalism, because when journalism grows disconnected from the communities that it serves, trust is damaged. Trust is lost. There were so many moments today for me, and I'm sure for all of you, that were critically important. We had moments of critique. We had moments of explanation about why practices work the way they do. We had moments of hope. I'm very hopeful coming out of this. And I'm deeply proud that the Center for Journalism Ethics is part of bringing us all here together today, whether you are a journalist or practicing or related to a newsroom, whether you're a member of the public who's concerned about where we're at and wants to do more about this, whether you're a student who's trying to learn this business and make your mark in it. I'm glad that we're all together. I would say to those of you who are here not connected with journalism that I would love to see you give your eyeballs and your dollars to pay for journalism and support it. But I'd also like to see you have your own courage in trying to hold it accountable and to demanding that it do what it should for you. To the journalists and the students in the room, I would say I'd love to see you sweep aside the curtain, very thick, velvety curtain that seems to hang between the practices of newsrooms and the publics that you're trying to serve. We are largely really bad at talking about our decisions, how hard they are to make. I completely agree with Jill, with the point Megan made, that why don't we say more about how difficult this is and why we do what we do? Open yourselves to challenge. Take your own mind and look at your own biases. I'm gonna retweet Joanne Miller here and say, journalists are people too. And we need to think about that. We can't just rely that, you know, for some reason the decision that we made to be a journalist means we're automatically shielded from things like motivated reasoning. If we have those conversations, if there are better bridges, if there's more proximity between news organizations and the people that we serve, I do have hope. I think that my bet for the future is engagement. I don't think that we can defend truth. I don't think that we can ensure trust unless we engage. So your homework is to take all of these things that you heard today, all of those important moments, and think about how we can engage together and how we can ensure that this incredibly vital, sometimes flawed, but incredibly vital institution known as the news media plays the role that it's destined to play in this democracy. So with that, thank you all for coming, and thank you to everybody who gave us their time today.